If you want to make a sound effects library or a sample pack, but don't really know how to go about doing it, this tutorial will show you my process from start to finish. I'll be going over how to make and record sounds at the industry standard, and adding metadata to make it easier to search for your sounds in a DAW. After that, packaging, where I'll talk about making cover art, a demo track, and other files you may need to include in your library. Finally, I'll point out some great websites where you can sell your stuff, so stick around. Hey everyone, Jake from Transverse Audio here. To dive right into it, there are some main things you should set up first to make a high-quality sound library. First, you may want a large dB or decibel meter to see the precise levels of each sound or sample you make. This will help things be uniform across the entire library, and if you set it to around negative 80 dB, you'll have a much clearer understanding of where to make your edits at the end of a sound. Then you'll need something to record with, and add fade points to prevent pops and clicks. Personally, I love to use Edison for this as it makes the whole process a lot easier. When it comes to a recording plugin, I like to have multiple instances of it so I can hold variations that I'm not sure about. So if I recorded 12 versions of a sound but can only keep 6, I want to be able to move on if I can't decide. The last few things you might want are an EQ to roll off anything below 20 Hz to give your sound clarity, as anything below that isn't really heard, a limiter to prevent clipping, even though you should typically aim for a level around negative 1 dB, but I'll go anywhere between negative 2 and negative 4 while just keeping it turned off until I need it. Lastly, you might want a notebook or any other text editor inside your project, so you can keep track of ideas and remind yourself of the standards you have for the library. Then you'll need to set up your DAW to work in the right quality depending on what you're making. To do this, go into the Options or Preferences menu and then to the Audio settings. For sound effects libraries used in media like games or film, it's kind of the standard to use a sample rate of 96 kHz and a resampling quality or bit rate of 24-point sync, or 24-bit. Anything higher than that is just not worth it for the amount of space it takes, and the quality past that is marginal at best. I don't even think it's something that can be heard. Now for the fun part. Let's make some sounds. Keep in mind that a lot of plugins legally prohibit you from using their presets in sound libraries. That means you're not allowed to record them as is and put them in your pack, even if you don't charge money for them. If you really don't know much about making your own sounds, you can learn a lot about synthesis by deconstructing sounds and essentially reverse designing a patch. But don't reverse engineer the plugin, because that's illegal too. Just take away effects or drop parameters off one at a time, observing how it changes the sound. This isn't the video for a full breakdown of making a sound effect, so I'll just skim over one sound so you can get an idea of how it's done. So the sound I made here largely has to do with the chorus effect and automating its parameters. And with it turned on. Down to its basics, this sound is made up of white noise, a sine wave, which is affected by the pitch controlled by the LFO, and lastly, a square or pulse wave. Altogether, and with the pitch back to its setting, it sounds like this. Without using the LFO and pitch, it sounds a lot different. I'm using a randomized LFO that has a maxed out gain and offset so it can give it a gradual change. With it controlling the pitch, I'm able to keep the high-pitched metallic sound from the white noise while dropping the sine and square wave down to a really low level. This combination acts kind of like a phaser but controls the frequencies in a different way. The pitch is automated so it can give the sound effect a thump at the end, making it sound more like a flux in spacetime. Now, what's really going on in the chorus is I have the depth set to halfway. This is what's giving it the shrieking metallic sound. The feedback is pretty much controlling how much of the signal is fed back through the effect again, kind of amplifying the sound. The rate being automated isn't doing a whole lot, but it does make the ending more dynamic as it transitions the sound a bit. But at its lowest setting, it does have a huge impact on the sound. Now, the chorus delay being automated the way it is lets the sound have a progressive change in pitch at the beginning while settling it down near the end to give the sound more of an impact. With the setup and sounds ready, you can start to record what you've made. First, enable loop markers so it's easier to deal with multiple variations. Disabling selection snapping will let you edit exact sections you want. Then right-click on the info bar and make sure it's recording at 96 kHz, and since it can't record in 24-bit for some reason, select 32-bit. This is because you can convert something from a higher to lower quality while keeping it at the best it can be. But going from a lower bit or sample rate up won't change the quality at all, and will probably just make the file bigger. The more you and the customer have to work with, the better. So set up loop points in the sequencer or piano roll to record the tail of the sound too. Once you've recorded the sound, it's good to keep the file short and without much silence. What I mean by this is you should remove the silence before and after the sound effect to keep the file size low, but don't make it abruptly end. You should have it naturally fade out. Once recorded, I like to make it fade in and out very quickly to make sure it doesn't click or pop when the sound starts or finishes. I try to keep this at 0.1 seconds or less, depending on how it affects the sound. If you're going to be making drones or ambiences, the standard length is around 30 to 60 seconds, although you can get away with a shorter sound at around 15 to 30 seconds if you make them seamlessly loop. If you want to learn about seamless looping, check out the card to the top right. I made a video about how to do it. Now for sounds other than that, it's good to get a few variations of each sound so things don't get too repetitive, like footsteps for example. There's no real standard for this, but anything between 3 and 6 should be great. This could be with slightly different parameters on your effects or synths. It really comes down to the sound and its typical use case in the game or a film. You can either keep them all separate or merge the variations into the same file with a small space between each. Finally, name your sound effect by right-clicking on the info bar. Then make sure you don't have anything selected by double-clicking on the waveform and then click and hold the drag button and drag your sound effect over to the sound libraries folder, which you'll have to make first, by the way. Now, if you didn't get a chance to set up the proper levels on your sounds you've already exported, there is a fix. Load up all of your sounds into a project on their own track in the playlist and in the mixer. From there, you can adjust the decibel level to the same amount and keep things consistent. Again, you don't want to slam everything to 0 dB. Instead, keep it around negative 2 and negative 4. You can also throw in some other effects like EQ and compression on individual tracks to fix up some sounds that are a bit off. Just keep in mind that it's a lot more efficient for you to fix something than it would be to leave it for every customer to fix it on their own. Not to mention, it's better for your brand's reputation. If you end up doing it this way, you'll need to export each track individually. If you're using FL Studio, you can simply right-click on the playlist track, then down to Consolidate This Track, and then from Track Start. This will automatically select the exact length of the individual track, regardless of how long or short others are. You will have to rename each file if you do it this way, and verify that the resampling is still at 24-bit. As the final step into making the actual content in a sound library, it's great to add metadata to each sound, to make it much easier for whoever uses the pack. There's expensive software like SoundMiner, or free software like Soundly, that you can use to add this in. The most important field you should be using is the description, to describe what the sound is, usually done with keywords separated by commas so it can be easily searched. This could be the genre, the kind of sound such as pulse or sweep, and even things like music or loop. Originator is a helpful one to market your brand so people can find the rest of your content. And I like to use Note to highlight my website and social media handle, but can be used for anything. And then there's Category to explain what the sound is with an umbrella term such as ambience, game audio, or even the name of the sound library or sample pack. Now we can move on to the packaging of the library. And this part is just as important. First, I'll go over making the cover art, then a demo track, and finally some extra files to add into the pack. All right, if you're not that artistic, you might want to pay someone to make your library artwork on a site like Fiverr if you want it cheap. If you're feeling artistic and want to do it yourself, which is probably easier, you can start by getting some artwork for free by going to a royalty-free stock photo site such as Unsplash or Pixabay. Once you find a CC0, preferably non-attribution photo, you can load it into a free editor such as GIMP. Cover art is typically 600 by 600 pixels, so set it up for that and then move in some rulers to help keep things on point. If you want a quick and easy way instead, there's a site called Canva that comes with templates. Just pick the CD cover and either use what they have or drag in a photo that you found. From there, it's just a matter of putting in the text if you want it. Time for the demo track to highlight whatever your pack has. The length of this track is going to be relative to the amount of sounds that are in your library, and how long each sound is, and should be ordered along the lines of best to worst, all while showing your best work in it. Basically, you're not trying to showcase every single sound included, just enough to get your point across and show its capabilities. If you're not a composer, you can go pick up an ambient track from a stock music site like Audio Jungle or Audio Network. Just remember to read the terms and conditions, making sure you can use it in this way. If you're also a composer, making your own soundtrack is more than ideal. Keep things simple as to not take away attention from the sounds you're trying to sell or give away for free, depending on how you price it. Make sure it's consistent with the theme of the pack too. To wrap it all up, put everything in the same folder and you don't have to put the demo track in there too. You probably shouldn't anyway. It is good to include any legal information into the library as a simple text document explaining the EULA or end user license agreement. You are, after all, selling the license to legally use your sounds. You can name this file README and even put your business information above the agreement to let people know where they can find more of your stuff. Finally, it's time to put your sound library or sample pack up for sale. You can either sell it on your own website or submit it to a retailer that sells libraries from many brands. Some good websites to look into are A Sound Effect, which sells full libraries, the Envato Market or Audio Jungle, typically for individual files, and game engine asset stores like Unity and Unreal, where you can sell stock music too. You can submit your library to be sold on as many websites as you want, and this can be any time before or after you've launched the product. These sites will, however, take a portion of the revenue made from each sale they make. It's kind of like a commission or royalty that only applies to the copy sold on their website. So you could sell it on your own website to keep 100% of the revenue, but you'll probably have to pay some percentage to a payment service like Stripe or PayPal. Both ways to sell your sound effects have their pros and cons. If you sell it through a retailer, you don't keep as much from each sale, but you can get more sales since they may have a lot more traffic and a larger audience that can be completely different from the one you have. Even though it may seem that all of the work is done, marketing your product is a very important step to take. This could be as simple as talking about it and bringing it up in conversation, or as far as running ads and promoting it on social media. Either way, it's good to go into this with a strategy. Remember, this is just my way of doing it. Ask yourself if there's a better way depending on the software you use. Give this video a like if you enjoyed it, and subscribe for more content like this. As always, thanks for watching.